Matthew chapter 1, verse 18, it says, "Now the birth of Jesus Christ was on this wise. When as his mother Mary was espoused to Joseph, before they came together, she was found with child of the Holy Ghost." Now there are, from verse 18 to verse 25, the Bible tells us about the visitation of the angel. That the angel visited Mary, gave her the news, and then it tells us that Mary became pregnant as a virgin. It tells us about the struggles of Joseph. Joseph was trying to figure out whether he should keep her and get married to her, or whether he should put her away privately. In fact, in the Jewish mindset, when you are betrothed, this is the betrothal. First there is the engagement, the betrothal, then the marriage. You are engaged from a very young age, and then you are betrothed. The betrothal means you are like you married. And then the marriage is when you celebrate and you go through all that and then you sleep together. So it is like, the betrothal is like the marriage. So when Joseph saw that that Mary was pregnant, he was troubled. So this is why he said that he thought to put her away privately, meaning like a divorce, privately. Then he tells us about the visitation of the angel in Joseph's dream. And then Joseph decides to marry her. And then you find that when Jesus is born, Joseph names Jesus, Jesus. He calls his name Jesus. And so we see that this is a story that starts from before Jesus was born, the struggles of Joseph, and then when Jesus was born, the name of Jesus. And so I want to talk to us about three significant truths from the birth of Christ relating to this passage that we will be reading from verse 18 to verse 25. So in verse 18, as we first read, that when his mother Mary was espoused to Joseph, that's the betrothal, before they came together, that means before they slept together, before the marriage was consummated, it says Mary was found to be pregnant with the Holy Spirit. This is a very significant truth. This is very powerful for Christians today. And so the first point is, the birth of Christ was a virgin birth. The birth of Jesus was a virgin birth. Then in verse 25, if you can look at verse 25, it says, Joseph, he knew her not, meaning he did not sleep with Mary, have sexual relationship, till she had brought forth her firstborn son, and he called his name Jesus. In other words, Joseph did not sleep with Mary at all in a relationship, physical relationship, until Jesus was born. So it tells us very clearly and carefully that this birth was a virgin birth. This is a very important thing. The Bible focuses on the virgin birth of Jesus. There's a reason for that. I hope you understand what I'm going to say next. The reason is because sin, you know, the nature of sin, sin itself is passed through the male line, the male seed. When Adam committed sin against God in the Garden of Eden, from that time till today, through the male seed, sin passes through every human family. All right, let me give you a scripture for that. In Romans chapter 5 and in verse 12, we'll come back to Matthew chapter 1. Romans 5, Romans chapter 5 and in verse 12. This is what it says. Wherefore has by one man sin entered the world. Now who's that man? Through Adam, sin entered the world. Then it says, and death by sin, and so death passed upon all men, for that all have sinned. See, because of Adam, all have sinned. Because of Adam, every man after Adam passes on the life of sin. And so, you notice that it's very important for us to realize that when Jesus was conceived in Mary's womb, He was conceived without sin, sinless. Every other man, every other person, woman, child, youth, when they conceived in their mother's womb, they conceived in sin. All right? Are you all with me? So Jesus was born sinless. Everybody say sinless. This is very important, and I'm going to tell you a few more things. Jesus was born completely without sin, sinless. You know why? Because from the Old Testament, every person who sinned, they had to kill an innocent animal in order for the blood to be shed to sacrifice so that that sin can be covered. Every sin, an innocent animal had to die. Every sin, an innocent animal had to die in order to cover that sin. You can see how it works now. But those sins, those sacrifices, were not perfect. Every person who sinned had to keep sacrificing an innocent animal. That is why there had to be a perfect sacrifice. Not an animal, a human being without sin. Okay, are you still with me? A human being without sin. This is why the virgin birth of Christ was perfect. Jesus is the perfect sacrifice. And let me give you another scripture, Hebrews chapter 10. Let's turn quickly to Hebrews chapter 10. Hebrews 10 and in verse 4. Okay, Hebrews 10 and in verse 4. This is what it says. It is not possible that the blood of bulls and goats should take away sins. Okay? The blood of animals cannot take away sins. It can only cover it. Okay, have you heard of cover-up? This is the one. It only covers sins, but it cannot wash it away. Only the blood of Christ can wash away our sins. Only the blood of Christ can purge our conscience from remembering the pain of those sins. Only the blood of Christ can completely cleanse us so that we can stand before God sinless as well. Okay? Now, in verse, if you can jump down to verse 10, Hebrews 10, and in verse 10, Hebrews 10, verse 10, this is what it says, by the which will we are sanctified. The word sanctified means to be made holy. By the which will? Whose will? Through God's will. By sending His own Son, by the which will we are made holy or sanctified through the offering of the body of Jesus Christ once for all. Jesus did not have to be sacrificed again and again and again. Only once for all time, Jesus was sacrificed to make us, all of us, holy. Are you with me? You and I do not have to commit a sin, run to an innocent animal, kill the animal to cover that sin, but we still have the guilty conscience of that sin. You understand? So every time we sin, we kill an animal, cover the sin, but we still carry guilty conscience. But through the blood of Jesus, the perfect sinless sacrifice, our sin is not covered, it is washed. Our conscience is cleared of guilty conscience. You and I are made sanctified. We are made holy by the blood of Jesus Christ. That is why it's a significant truth. If Jesus was not born of a virgin, you and I would be lost. We'd be walking around with always that guilty conscience. We'd always be looking for animals to be sacrificed. Always trying to cover us rather than washing us. Would you rather be, you know, just like, for example, if you have to go somewhere, but, you know, you don't want to bath. Okay, so what you do is you spray yourself. You're covered in spray. You know, but it's not the same thing, is it? From when you go and have a clean, nice shower and you wash away the dirt. Amen? So that when you spray yourself, you know the perfume comes from a good place. You understand what I'm saying? Okay. The blood of Jesus doesn't just cover your sin, it washes you clean. And the Bible tells us, once and for all, you don't have to keep sacrificing Jesus. Now, every time I commit a sin, I don't have to go back to the temple of, you know, temple in Jerusalem and sacrifice. You know what I do? The Bible tells us in 1 John 1:9, I simply confess my sins. If I confess my sins, the blood of Jesus, the Bible says, the blood of Jesus cleanses me from all sin and from all unrighteousness. That is amazing. Amen. Now, the second thing is this. If you can go to verse 22, Matthew chapter 1, let's jump back to that. Matthew chapter 1, verse 22. Matthew 1, verse 22. And it says, now all this was done that it might be fulfilled that which was spoken of the Lord by the prophet, saying, behold, a virgin shall be with child. She shall bring forth a son, and they shall call his name Emmanuel, which is being interpreted, God with us. The second point is, Jesus' birth is a fulfillment of Scripture, fulfillment of prophecy. You see, there's an author who actually wrote this, and he said that Jesus, through his birth, his ministry, 3.5 years or so ministry, his death, burial, and resurrection fulfilled about 44 prophecies. Now that's amazing. Jesus, through his birth, ministry, death, burial, resurrection, fulfilled approximately 44 prophecies. Now, if you count 2 or 3 prophecies, humanly speaking, that would be almost impossible to think that those prophecies would be fulfilled in one person at one time in one place. It's almost humanly impossible. But to think that 44 prophecies to be fulfilled in one person, in one time, in one location, it's humanly impossible. Humanly impossible. The Bible says that the birth of Christ was a fulfillment of the prophecy, that it was spoken. So every prophecy came from 4,000 years before Jesus was born, 2,000 years, 1,500 years, 700 years, different prophets spoke at different stages of human history. Can you imagine how impossible to coordinate all the prophecies? This was not a man setup, amen? This was a divine setup. You can say it this way, man could not fulfill the prophecy. It was by the divine hand of God. God sovereignly orchestrated human history, human actors, so to speak, in this huge drama. God put everything in this place to fulfill prophecy in one person, one place, one time. And the encouragement to me is this. I'm coming to the crunch of the matter. The encouraging thing to me is this. If the prophecies was fulfilled in exact detail, if you study those prophecies, you can see that exact detail, those prophecies were fulfilled. If those prophecies were fulfilled in his birth, his ministry, his death, his burial, and resurrection, 44 prophecies, then we are sure that the prophecies concerning his second coming will be fulfilled in exact detail. Isn't that amazing? Now the challenge for all of us this morning is this. Are you ready for his coming? Are you ready for his coming? Because if we are not ready, but prophecies is showing us that Jesus' coming was Jesus' first coming, his ministry, burial, and resurrection was fulfilled in exact detail. If we are not ready, then there will be no excuse for us on that great day. There are prophecies which speak of his second coming. Prophecies that speak of the millennium reign of Christ. Prophecies that speak of the new heaven and the earth. There are prophecies that are yet to be fulfilled. Prophecies that speak even of today, of these times that we are suffering today. There are prophecies that spoke of this time and the times to come. I'm excited. I'm really excited because I know my Savior is coming. The perfect King, the perfect Redeemer, the perfect Savior, the perfect High Priest is coming again. And I'm looking forward to the fulfillment of that prophecy. So as I celebrate Christmas, it was Christmas yesterday, but as I celebrate the birth of Christ, I also prepare my heart for His coming. I know my Lord and Savior will come again, and He will split the clouds of glory and ascend on Mount Olives in Jerusalem. You know what? Some other people are waiting for a Messiah. I know my Messiah is coming on the Mount of Olives. He will split the earth in two, and He'll march through the gate, and we will welcome Him on that day. Praise the living God. You know something? If you are losing hope because of the pandemic, I want you to know God is in control. I want you to know that as you celebrate the birth of Christ, Jesus and His Father and the Holy Spirit is exactly in control, because every detail will be fulfilled. Every detail. Without question, every detail will be fulfilled. Now let me close with this final point. Let's go down to verse 21. This is the final point. The first is the virgin birth. Second is the fulfillment of Scripture. And the third point, verse 21, He shall bring forth a son, and thou shalt call His name Jesus, for He shall save His people from their sins. The name Jesus means God saves, or Jehovah saves, or Yahweh saves. Okay? He shall save His people from their sins. And then let's just jump down to verse 25, that when Jesus was born, this is what Joseph did. He did not know her, Mary, till she had brought forth her firstborn son, and he called his name Jesus. The birth of Christ reveals to us the name of Jesus. You know, this is something that's so powerful. You know, sometimes we hardly talk about it, we hardly teach about it, but the name of Jesus was revealed in the birth of Christ. The circumstances, the angel appearing to Mary, telling her, you know, Jesus, and Him being born, and Joseph naming the son Jesus. This is very significant. And I will explain it to you now. So I want you to put on your thinking cap. Turn to your neighbor and say, put on your thinking cap. All right? I don't want you to sleep on me. The rain is sounding outside. It's nice and cool. The fan is blowing. Please don't sleep, because I'm going to take you on a little journey, because I want you to know the name of Jesus is so wonderful. And it came through the birth of Christ. Acts chapter 4 verse 12. You can refer to that in your own time. But this is what it says. There is none other name given under heaven whereby we must be saved. Amen? The name of Jesus. There is none other name given under heaven whereby man must be saved. And what do we know that name? Jesus Christ. There is no other name. No other prophet died for you. No other famous person died for you. Every prophet and savior other than Jesus died with a human father. I mean, was born of a human father. But Jesus was born without any human father. The power of the Holy Spirit came upon Mary, and she gave birth to a sinless savior. And so the name of Jesus is the only name that can save. So let me take you on this journey. Why is the name of Jesus so powerful? Because when Jesus was born, He was given that name. Now let me show you how this is so important for us today. Now you can turn in your own time. Okay, I'm going to just tell you what the scripture says. But the next scripture, I'm going to read it with us. Okay, so 2 Chronicles 6, verse 18 to 20. 2 Chronicles chapter 6, verse 18 to 20. This is Solomon. He is dedicating the temple. He spent many years building this temple. Okay, he spent millions, in today's terms, billions of dollars building this great temple. And now he's dedicating this temple. And this is what he says. I'll say it in my own words. God, even the heaven of heavens cannot contain you, much less this house that I have built. However, you said that you would put your name into this house. Okay, do you get what I'm saying? Solomon is saying, God, you cannot be inhabited in this house. Even the heavens cannot contain you. But this house is a place where you said you'd put your name. In other words, the temple is a place where God would put His name. Right? Now, I want us to turn now and we'll read together 2 Chronicles 7, the very next chapter. 2 Chronicles chapter 7. Where are you? 2 Chronicles
chapter 7. Okay.
Now this is what it says. Now when Solomon had made an end of praying, the fire came down from heaven, consumed the burnt offering and the sacrifices, and the glory of the Lord filled the house. And the priests could not enter into the house of the Lord, because the glory of the Lord had filled the Lord's house. When the children of Israel saw how the fire came down, and the glory of the Lord upon the house, they bowed themselves with their faces to the ground upon the pavement, and worshipped and praised the Lord, saying, "For He is good, and His mercy endures forever." Now this is very significant, because this is an Old Testament example of what is coming in reality. The Old Testament is what we call a shadow. When you look around the room, you see shadows, okay? Those shadows are not the real thing. What's the real thing? The person sitting on the chair. Okay, now you get me? The Old Testament is just the shadow. So here we see in the Old Testament, Solomon is dedicating the temple. God placed your name into this temple. Now we're reading in the very next chapter, as he finishes prayer, what happens is this. The Holy Spirit, the Spirit of glory, comes from heaven and it fills the temple. So much so that the priests could not even stand. They could not stand. Can you imagine how tangible was the glory of God? The temple, the name of God was placed in the temple, and the glory of God filled the temple. They could not stand. You know what they did? They bowed down and they said, you know, and they glorified the Lord in worship. Now let me tell you this. When Jesus was born, the temple of God was born. Are you with me? When Jesus was born, the temple of God was born. Because in John chapter 2, let's turn quickly. John chapter 2, verse 19. Okay, I don't want to lose you, so stay with me, okay? John chapter 2, verse 19. This is what it says. Jesus answered and said unto them, "Destroy this temple, and in 3 days I will raise it up." Verse 21. Or verse 20. Then said the Jews, 46 years was his temple in building. The Jews were talking about the stone building, right? The stone temple. But what was Jesus talking about? Destroy this temple. What is he talking about? Verse 21. But he spoke of the temple of his body. There was two temples standing there that day. One was the temple of stone, and the next was the temple of Jesus' body. The Old Testament temple was just the shadow, but the reality was standing there in the flesh. Are you with me? I mean, this is, oh, praise God. Fasten your seatbelt, guys, because I'm telling you, I'm excited about this. When the temple of Solomon was dedicated, this is an Old Testament example, not even New Testament. Temple of Solomon was dedicated. The name of God was placed in the temple. The glory of God filled it, that even the priest could not stand. It was so powerful. Can you go now and you think, when Jesus was born, the temple of God was born. And the angel said, "You shall call his name Jesus." When Jesus was born, Joseph named him officially Jesus. You know what was happening? The name of Jesus was placed in the temple. The reality now is happening now. The Old Testament was just the shadow. The reality is happening. The name of God was placed in this temple, a physical body, the body of Christ. And now when Jesus is baptized at the River Jordan, what comes upon Jesus? Come on, somebody. The Holy Spirit, the Spirit of glory, comes from heaven and it comes upon the Son of God, who is the temple of God. And what happens is he goes out for 40 days temptation, comes back. And what happens is, everywhere he goes, the power of God begins to manifest. Just like in the temple of Solomon, the power of God manifested, they could not even stand. Wherever Jesus went, the blind saw, the deaf heard, the crippled got up and walked. Are you with me? Now, every time, and this is the exciting time for you and I, we celebrate Christmas because it's an acknowledgement that every time, every person comes to Jesus, what happens is this. You and I become the temple of God. When you gave your life to Jesus, you know what? You move from just a person, a physical body out there, an unbeliever, separated from God, But the moment you come to Christ, bang, you become a temple of God. Now let's go down to 1 Corinthians 3:16. Let's just jump quickly. 1 Corinthians 3:16. And then we'll close. 1 Corinthians 3:16, this is what it says. Don't you know that you are the temple of God? Wow. Don't you know that you are the temple of God? What else did he say? And that the Spirit of God dwells in you. Isn't that amazing? The shadow is now fulfilled in the reality, Jesus, and now it's fulfilled in us. We are the reality. So guess what? The temple, the name, the glory, and what else happens? The power. No wonder Jesus said in Mark 16, let's just turn and just close with that. Sorry, let's just close with that. Mark 16. What did Jesus say about believers? He connected it to his name. And he said this. In Mark 16, verse 15, go into all the world, preach the gospel to every creature. He that believes is baptized shall be saved. He that believes not shall be damned. This sign shall follow them that believe. Okay, when you believe and you give your life to Christ, these signs will follow. Why? Because now you are the temple of God. The name of Jesus is in you. When you give your life to Christ, what comes into you, placed in you, in this temple? The name of Jesus. And the Holy Spirit lives in you. Then what does it say? These signs shall follow them that believe. In my name, they shall cast out devils. Wow. They shall speak with new tongues. They shall take up serpents. If they drink any deadly thing, it shall not hurt them. They shall lay hands on the sick, and they shall recover. That's the power. That's the power. That means every person who gives his heart to the Lord is a walking temple of God. You are a walking temple. You have the name of Jesus placed inside you. And inside you, wherever the name of Jesus is, the Holy Spirit comes and He fills. He fills you. And now, Jesus said, go into all the world. Wherever you go, in the name of Jesus, signs will follow. Praise the Lord. It's not about you. It's about the sinless Savior. Jesus was born sinless so that we might be redeemed. There's a perfect sacrifice once and for all, so that when we give our lives to Christ, we become the temple of God. Christmas is a celebration of the reality of what Jesus has done for us. I don't have to walk around in fear any longer. Fearful of the demons, or fearful of circumstances or the pandemic. Why? I am the walking temple of God. You are the walking temple of God. The glory of God is in you. Whether you feel it or you don't feel it. Whether you feel depressed or don't feel depressed. When you believe in Christ, you become the temple of God. And you walk with the glory of God. You can be sick and yet demons still fear who you have on the inside of you. You can be depressed and yet demons still fear who you have on the inside of you. Bui and I, sometimes when we go out and do deliverance ministry, I remember one time we saw a lady. As soon as she walked in the house this way, she walked, ran outside that way. It's nothing to do with us. It's who we have on the inside. Amen? Another lady, you know, came in from the village and she said to Bui, I cannot look into his eyes. Now listen to this. I cannot look into his eyes because it's full of stars. How's that, Brother Norman? I cannot look into his eyes because it's full of stars. I mean, of course, I can talk about it now, but at that time, it was like almost terrifying because this lady had demons inside her and she was manifesting. But guess what? That demon was afraid of who I had on the inside. The same glory of God that is that was inside Jesus, the Holy Spirit, He shared it with His body, His temple, walking, living, breathing temple of God. Not in Jerusalem. Thank God some people go to Jerusalem. Thank God for the Wailing Wall. We go to the Wailing Wall and we feel the presence of God as well. But that's a stone. That's a shadow. The reality is here right now. You and I. The birth of Christ opened the door for us to walk in the reality of God. So wherever you are today,
I want you to know something. God has a purpose for your life. Go into all the world, preach the gospel. Amen?
If your neighbor is sick, don't say to your neighbor, wait, I have to call pastor. No, you are the temple of God. Amen? Just go. Wait, brother. Wait, sister.
The power is going to flow.
You may not feel it, you may not see it, but you must believe it.
Because the glory lives inside you.
You know, you can't see it. Maybe look in the mirror. I mean, don't go home today and look carefully for the stars. Amen? Why? The stars is in you. The glory of God is inside you. You can't see it. But spiritual beings, angels, demons can see the glory of God living inside you. No wonder Paul says we have this treasure in earthen vessels. We have this treasure in earthen vessels. We are earthen. Amen?
But the treasure is inside of us. The glory that we carry. Because you are the temple of God.
Amen. Let's pray. Let's just go before the Lord and let's pray this morning.